Hey, good morning. Welcome to Christ Community. If you wouldn't mind standing with us this morning. Hey, so those of you who are here, man, what a blessing it is for all of us to be able to gather together this morning in freedom, in joy. No matter what we've gone through this week, we can still enter into God's presence knowing that He is the one who saves. He is the only one who does the impossible in our lives. And it's such a blessing knowing that we have a God who not only loves us, not only rules over us, but listen, He serves our needs. He doesn't have to, but He does. And what a blessing it is to know that He's the only one who can ever meet that deepest part of us. And this morning, if you that, if you've experienced Him, man, then lift your voice in song. Raise your hands, clap your hands, shout for joy. This is the place where His people come together and we glorify His name together. Amen? Hey, we're going to teach you guys a new song. So yeah, go ahead, praise Him. We're going to teach you guys a new song this morning. It's called Only Jesus Can. And it's such a song that's very powerful, man, when you think about what the words mean. That only He can do it. Not only do we say that, but man, He proves it on a day-to-day basis. And so this morning, I'm going to go ahead and sing the chorus for you this morning, okay? And then I'm going to have you sing it with me again, and then we'll start the song. And it goes like this. He can do it. Yes, He can. He will move it. Our God can. No one else can save us, redeem us, create a new life in us. Only Jesus can. So go ahead and sing that with me again. He can do it, yes He can, He will prove it, our God can. No one else can save us, redeem us, create a new life in us, only Jesus can. Can He breathe into the dust? Can He make sons out of us? Life is in His mighty hands. Our life is in our mighty hands. He can do it. Yes, He can. He will prove it. God can. No one else can save us, redeem us, create a new life in us. Only Jesus can.
sin can. Can he heal the leper's limb? Can he cleanse us from within? Can we drink from living streams? Can we ever be redeemed? And this is the answer. He has healed the leper's limb. He has cleansed us from within. We have drunk from living streams. Surely we have been redeemed. He can do it. Yes, he can. He will prove it. Our God can. No one else can save us, redeem us, create a new life in us. Only Jesus can. He can do it. Yes, he can. He will prove it. Our God can. No one else can save us, redeem us, create a new life in us. Only Jesus can. And only Jesus can. Only Jesus can.
Amen. What a wonderful God we serve. Amen.
Sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is a done for me. conquer the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who came. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Yeah, this is amazing grace.
Since you all are in such a good mood, why don't you turn to someone next to you and say, God loves you. Oh, praise the Lord. He is so good. Man, he has a heart like no one else to remember all of his goodness, all of his benefits, everything that he's done, man. It's good. It's good. And all creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing. Oh, praise Him. Hallelujah. Thou burning sun with golden beam, thou silver moon with softer gleam. Oh, praise Him. Oh, praise Him. Hallelujah. 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 And thou rushing wind that art so strong, ye clouds that sail in heaven along, oh, praise Him. Hallelujah. Thou rising moon in praise rejoice. Ye Continuing on with that theme, man, that the Lord can save to the uttermost. I know there's many of us in here, just about all of us can say that the Lord saved me when I was at my worst. When I thought that I was untouchable, unreachable, He came in and turned my life around, showed me His grace and His love. Showed me what life was meant to be. Thank you, God. And who, oh Lord, could save themselves? Their own soul could heal. Our shame was deeper than the sea. Your grace is deeper still. Thank you.
To gather here this morning, and our prayer is that you would receive the highest praise from our hearts, that as we sing unto you, that you would receive the highest praise, as we pray together with one another, like-minded and in unity, that you would receive the highest praise, that as we hear the unfolding of your word before our very eyes and hearts, that you would receive the highest praise through us bowing to your word and its authority and obeying it in our lives. The last thing we want to become, Lord, is a country club, a social club. We realize that when you saved us, you redeemed us, bought us, incorporated us into the kingdom of God, and there is a serious work to be done here on earth. Lord, let us never lose sight of the gospel. Thank you for the many times and opportunities that you've given us to minister to the poor. Thank you for the opportunity that we have to feed and clothe some of those who are needy in our own community, but also abroad. Thank you for the opportunity to minister to persecuted pastors and support refugee children. But Lord, let us never lose sight of the gospel. It is more than a word that is to be played out indeed in our good works. It is a word to be preached and to call sinners into salvation with you. Thank you, Jesus. May you pour out your spirit this morning for the glory of the resurrected Jesus Christ. And Lord, as we enter into this service, we renounce darkness in every wicked corner in our hearts. We renounce sin, Lord, that has been glorified and toyed with and Lord, we give you the highest praise this morning because you are worthy, Lord. May our hearts reflect that today in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. Hey. All right. God is so good. This is my favorite time of the week. Amen. Is it yours? Yes. Hey, we are going to dedicate a baby this morning. That's what we're beginning with. And I am so excited to be able to dedicate little Lily. Isn't she adorable? Richard and Michelle. Yes. Richard and Michelle are very special to me because they started coming to church here. And when they started coming to church here, they lived together. Because that's what the culture says, right? And to be honest with you, even many Christians do not even realize that that is wrong today because churches just don't address it. They don't deal with it. They've really caved into the culture in many areas and they're afraid of losing people or whatever. But we're called to bring the truth to people. And when the truth was brought to Richard and Michelle, I remember the conversation well in our office, and they gladly said, Pastor Walt, we do want to make things right. We do want to be right with the Lord. So I had the opportunity to perform their wedding. And now I have the opportunity to dedicate their baby. God blessed them tremendously. And I see that just in little Lily here. We got to know each other a little bit before service. We're going to see if she remembers. How many know babies have short memories? And I just want to read this scripture to you guys. I love it because it's Old Testament followed through in the New Testament. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment, with promise that it may be well with you and you may live long on the earth. And you fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath, but bring them up in the training and the admonition of the Lord. And they realize that this is their primary responsibility. And let's take little Lily. Look at that. See? Uh-oh. Whenever they put their shoulders back, it could be potential disaster. Whenever they look at mom and dad, it could be potential disaster. But if you just... Let's pray. Extend a hand this way. Lord, thank you. What a blessing Lily is. Just to hold her and see her when she came into this world. Just another endorsement of your goodness in Michelle and Richard's life. They responded in obedience to your word, Lord. And now their marriage is filled with your peace. And you at the center. And Lord, as we dedicate little Lily this morning, the scripture we read, we know will be played out in their household. I pray, Lord, for the parents, that as they make decisions for Lily, that they would put her spiritual well-being before anything. And Lord God, that as Lily grows up, she would hear your word continually. She would hear the conversations in the house about Jesus. She would be getting ready on Lord's Day to go to church and to be with other believers, to hear your word and to sing praise to you. And Lord, that you would flood this household with your blessings, and as they continue faithfulness and obedience to you, that we would see Lily grow up in your ways. And at the right time, Lord, only you know when that day is, that she would confess Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior. Fruit of her parents' obedience to you and your faithfulness in saving the lost. God, may your hand be upon this family now for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. Did you hear her start to complain a little bit? But then I noticed she turned her head and she saw all you good-looking people, and she stopped. Congratulations. Here's a gift from the church. Their quilt will come in the fall. The quilting ministry took vacation too, but they'll resume back in the fall, and they've got a quilt coming for you guys. Let's give them a hand. Bless you guys. Bless you. Thank you. All right. You know what? Before we go into announcements, I'm going to call Katie Mullane up here, and I want to call Mom and Dad up too, and Griselle. We're gonna pray for her. I'm so proud of this girl. She has grown up knowing Jesus because she has parents that taught her the Word of God, and she's getting ready. Tuesday, she leaves for Australia for 6 months, and it's on missions. She's youth with a mission, right? She'll be joining the mission, and so she'll be away from Mom and Pop for those 6 months. And I don't know who needs prayer more, her or Mom and Dad, but because this is certainly the first for Mom and Dad too. But what's awesome is, as you know, Mike is an elder in the church. He's discipled some of you out there and has always put a priority on God's Word. And so he and Michelle has always made Jesus Lord in their household. And so I know they trust God with their daughter as she has made the decision according to God's will to go down there. So let's pray for her today. Lord, thank you just for how Katie has grown up. I've seen her mature and grow in your ways, and she's grown up into this beautiful young woman who has a heart for you, Jesus. As she has followed your word, God, and I know it was the Holy Spirit that spoke to her heart that led her to go with Youth with a Mission down to Australia, that you're going with her. That, Lord, she is not an orphan. She's going with your presence. And I want to pray, Lord, ahead of time, that she would recognize and realize the divine appointments in her life. Lord, you have them set up. You have prepared good works for her to do even before the foundation of the world, according to Ephesians 2:10. So, Lord, as she goes down there, may she discover all the good works that you have prepared for her, and in obedience keep her hands to the plow, and we would see much fruit come forth from the ministry. Lord, protect her. Give Mom and Dad a peace while she is gone. I pray for them that as they trust you, God, that they would marvel at the wonderful works that you're going to do through their daughter. So God, protect all parties involved. May you raise up a hedge for them. And may your blessings be evident in her life as she follows through in obedience. In Jesus' name we pray. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. All right. Hey, go ahead and sit down. I know you've been standing a long time. But as you're being seated, go ahead and pull out your wallet. If you are today's or right now is tithe and offering time, hey, if you're watching on live stream, live feed, you can give online. So just go to our website on the section that has giving, and you can give online. Welcome, everybody. Isn't God faithful? How many knows that Jesus loves you?
Christ Community Church, thanks for being with us today. Have you stopped by our new bookstore yet? There are some really cool new styles in colors as hot as Imperial Valley summer of Christ Community Church's logoed hats and t-shirts now available. Stop by the check-in room next to the fellowship hall and check out church today. And while you're at the bookstore, pick up this amazing documentary video from Ray Comfort and Living Waters for only $1.
Imagine visiting some of the world's most prestigious universities, interviewing top evolutionary scientists, atheists, and holding their feet to the fire until it's clear that there is no evidence for Darwinian evolution, that it's not scientific.
So we have thousands of examples.
I can give you
thousands, just one.
To summarize, the observable evidence that you give me for Darwinian evolution is bacteria becoming bacteria.
Still bacteria, there's no change of kind.
Evolution versus God. If you believe in evolution, prepare to have your faith shaken.
We'll be hosting a weekly parenting class called Created to Connect, geared toward foster and adoptive kids and kids from hard places, but any parent or person who works with children in any capacity is welcome and encouraged to attend. It'll be on Mondays, beginning July 20th, from 5:30 to 7 p.m. in the family room. Books are $25 and childcare is available. With the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, sign up online or call the office and put your name on the list to be baptized on August 9th during our worship service. Junior high and high school girls are invited to a sleepover at the home of Maria Whitehead on Friday, July 24th. Meet in the Christ Community Church parking lot at 4:30 p.m. on Friday for transportation to Mrs. Whitehead's house. You'll return to the parking lot on Saturday at 9 a.m. to be picked up by your parents. Bring your Bibles, pajamas, sleeping bags, pillows, and snacks. Expect fun, games, giggling, food, movies, and a tiny, tiny bit of sleep. Maybe. See Nicole Espino for permission slips and information.
What is happening to my body?
It's called dancing.
My hands are in the air like I just do not care.
Your family will love the hit comedy of the year, DreamWorks Home.
Okay.
Ooh, I too has to break pee.
Bring your whole family and join us for DreamWorks Home, Wednesday, July 29th at 6:30 p.m. for family movie night. We're doing life together at Christ Community Church, but for that to happen, everyone needs to stay up to date and informed. So remember to read your bulletin, check out our website, follow us on Facebook, and text Christ Community to 42828. And sign up to get the weekly e-announcements. To stay in touch with Christ Community Church on your smartphone, there's an app for that. You can find CCC_mobile in your Apple or Android app store. With the app, you can follow our YouTube and Vimeo channels, read your Bible and take notes, do your online giving, and go to the CCC website through the app to watch the Sunday service stream. Now, as you're checking your cell phones to make sure they won't embarrass you this morning with their terrible timing, here's another resource available for everyone at Christ Community Church that you may not have been aware of or been taking advantage of. But you should start right now.
We're expanding our church library, but don't worry, we don't need you to show up with a hammer on Saturday. We've gone digital. Now everyone in our church can access a ton of great biblical teaching on video, anytime, anywhere. We know that spiritual questions don't just come up on Sunday. Any day of the week, we might face issues about our marriage or parenting or finances. And we're always looking for ways to deepen our understanding of prayer, of missions, or of discipleship. That's why we've given you instant access to great biblical teaching videos for all ages. By making this library of great biblical teaching available to you when and where you need it, this is just one more way we hope we can support and equip you on your journey of faith.
Man, Jacob, come on up. Jacob Prash doesn't need any introduction. Been here many times. But I do want to introduce his wife who is here for the first time. Where is Pavia? Pavia's right here. Welcome, Pavia. Pavia was born in Romania, raised in Israel, and that's where Jacob met her. She was seeking God. She was on her own quest to discover who God was. And they were ministering to the same Muslim man who had gangrene in his legs. And Jacob ends up leading Pavia to Jesus Christ. Her parents are Holocaust survivors. Although the rest of their family didn't make it through the Holocaust, her parents did. And so it is a pleasure to have you this morning, Pavia. And listen, after last night having dinner with him, this lady is so on fire for the Lord. Now I know why Jacob behaves so well.
I have a signal, now I got a signal. If you don't know me, you're not missing much. My name is Jacob, I've been here before. I'm a friend of your pastor, and it's a wonderful blessing to be with you here in El Centro. Our ministry is called Moriel. We do have a website, Moriel, M-O-R-I-E-L.org. also some of the finest propaganda this side of the Atlantic, although I live mainly in England. We have a couple of book and tape tables outside, should you be so inclined to visit us. We'd love to get to know you a bit personally. Nosotros tenemos para translación mexicanos en la otra sala. Yo soy Jacobo Presta. Nuestro ministerio es Muriel Ministries. Nosotros tenemos dos palabras hoy para una iglesia. Gringos no hay. Mexicanos no hay. Cristianos en Jesucristo solamente.
Hey, Jacob, before I forget, I want to apologize to those on the balcony for the camera. We're having lighting issues today, so the picture may not come in very clear on the live stream or that, but hopefully we'll have that fixed next week. And we actually, you and I, Jacob, look better this morning.
Well, as you can see, my pretty wife can still wear the same dress she got married in. I can't even fit through the door of the same church. Muchacho gordo. This morning I'd like to speak to you about my least favorite subject in the world. There is nothing I dislike speaking about more than I dislike speaking about this subject. It's not easy, and it's something that potentially, in fact, almost inevitably at some point, will affect every one of us. The most difficult thing you or I will ever face as Christians, as saved believers in Jesus, the most difficult challenge to our faith, the thing that will spiritually and emotionally cause us more grief, more challenge to our beliefs, more of a problem in coming to terms with than anything else that'll ever happen. The biggest problem we will ever have is not personal disappointment in this temporal world. People can experience professional failure, academic failure, failed relationships, business failure, setbacks in finance, setbacks in health, all kinds of problems. But nothing, including our own biological death, which is merely temporary, is going to be as big a problem as the real problem. The ultimate thing for ourselves, if we give up the ghost, to live as Christ, to die as gain. The Greek word is katargeo. In his own death and resurrection, Jesus abolished death. It doesn't concern us. It's like putting an inflated ball under the water in a swimming pool. You can put it under, but you can't keep it under. It's going to pop out again. The grave could not contain Jesus, and because of Jesus, it can't contain those who are in him. Now, if you're not in Jesus, you're in big trouble. No, it's not anything like that. The most difficult challenge you or I or any believer will ever face is coming to terms with the death of an unsaved loved one. A parent, husband, wife, God forbid a child, grandparent, the death of a sibling, a brother or a sister. There is nothing you or I will ever have to deal with in this world that will be more difficult, more problematic, more challenging than coming to terms with the loss of an unsaved loved one. I go to funerals, and you can always tell at a funeral of a Christian, there is grief, there is sadness, but never once at the funeral, at the grave of a believer, have I ever seen despair. Never. Never. There's only one fitting epitaph for a true believer in Jesus. Here lies so-and-so. Temporarily closed for renovations, will reopen soon. John 5:24. Though a man believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. you lose a Christian husband, Christian parent, Christian anything, I'm sorry for your loss. But make sure when you chisel in the epitaph at the cemetery, it says, temporarily closed for renovations, will reopen soon. Grief, yes. Mourning, yes. Sadness, yes. My condolences. But despair, never. Never. It's a temporary separation. Moreover, it is to their advantage. Now, the death of a loved one who's not saved, what can you say? What can you say to encourage the family? Nothing. Now, only God ultimately knows what may or may not transpire at the second the instance between life and death. Only God knows that. Only God ultimately knows what happens to someone. But we can know this. In the entire New Testament, we only have one deathbed conversion. Only one. And people who do get saved on their deathbed generally tend to be people who would have gotten saved sooner had they known the gospel. They may just be prompted into it by fear, and God will use that. If you have an unsaved loved one and you're praying for their salvation, God may bring adversity into their life. He may put them on their deathbed to scare them into repentance. Better that than the alternative. Better that than the alternative. If you're here today, there's people who love you who are here. We'd rather see anything other than you be eternally lost. Forever is a long time. No matter what people tell you, Jesus spoke of hell as a literal place. It was not made for people. Jesus said hell was made for Satan and his angels. Nobody should ever go there except for Satan and demons. Nobody should ever go there. It's such a terrible place and such a real place that God became a man and died in your place and in mine so we wouldn't go there. By all rights, I should go to hell. As a teenager, I was a Marxist. By the time I got to university, I was strung out on cocaine. I got through my exams in college by taking amphetamine. I was crazy. Then I became a dealer. I'm not proud of it, but that's what I was. That's what I did. And many of my friends are the same. I got friends who were dead. They're pushing up daisies. As far as I know, they're in hell. But I'm here today just because of what Jesus did for me. No reason he should have done it. No reason he should have done it. But I'm glad he did do it. And if he did it for me, he can do it for you. I got saved literally off the streets in New York. Before we turn to the Old Testament, turn with me, please, to the Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 12. Verse 46, while he was still speaking to the multitudes, behold, his mother and brothers were standing outside, seeking to speak to him. Notice Jesus had brothers. Now, I know that's a problem for certain people. No offense. And someone said to him, behold, your mother and your brothers are standing outside seeking to speak to you. And it's speaking of siblings in a biological context. It's not talking about neighbors or something like that. Your mother and your brothers. And he answered the one who was telling him and said, who is my mother and who are my brothers? And stretching out his hand towards his disciples, he said, behold, my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of my Father who is in heaven, he is my brother and my sister and my mother. Turn with me, if you will, please, to the Old Testament, 2 Samuel chapter 18. 2 Samuel chapter 18. A schism took place between the northern kingdom of Israel and the southern kingdom of Judah. It would be reunited under David's leadership, but again fragment because of the sin of Solomon. But it begins in verse 1, then David numbered the people who were with him and set over them commanders of thousands and commanders of hundreds. And David sent the people out, one-third under the command of Joab, one-third under the command of Abishai, the son of Zeruiah, Joab's brother, and one-third under the command of Ittai the Gittite. And the king said to the people, I myself will surely go with you also. David was hedging his bets. Scripturally and historically, judgments have always happened to the Jews in thirds. Always. Remember, Ezekiel was to cut off his hair. One-third he was to burn, one-third he was to chop up with a sword, and one-third scattered to the breeze, and a few he was to put into the tassels of the hem of his garment. Jesus said, not a hair of your head will perish. With the Babylonian captivity, one-third of the Jews were killed by the sword, by the Babylonians. One-third were asphyxiated when Nebuchadnezzar burned Jerusalem, and one-third were scattered to the diaspora. A few Jews survived. There's 613 commandments of the Torah, and there's one tassel on the hem of a Jew's garment. Today it's called the tallit for every commandment of the Torah, and he had to affix a few halves to those. In other words, the Jews who kept the word of God kept them. The rest, judgments happened in thirds. In the book of Zechariah, two-thirds of the Jews in Jerusalem are going to be killed by the Antichrist and his onslaught. Two-thirds. In the Holocaust of the 1930s and 40s, one-third of global Jewry and two-thirds of Europe were wiped out. Judgments have always happened in thirds. And so we continue. He breaks his army into thirds. Verse 3, but the people said, you should not go out, for if we indeed flee, they will not care about us, even if half of us die. But they'll care about us, but you are worth 10,000 of us. Therefore, it's better that you be ready to help us. Their love for King David is remarkable. King David is the Old Testament shadow of Christ as king and as shepherd. He's the Old Testament shadow of Jesus as king and as shepherd. Then the king said to them, whatever seems best to you, I will do. So the king stood next to the gate, and all the people went out by hundreds and by thousands. Now, David showed wisdom. Whatever seems best to you, I will do. This rebellion was instigated by his unbelieving son, or his backslidden son. His own son engineered the rebellion. Whenever you're dealing with family, objectivity goes out the window. The first casualty of dealing with a crisis involving a loved one is objectivity. It's so hard. Very often, unless it's a child, it's so hard to witness, to share the gospel to an unsaved loved one who knew you before you were saved. People who you never met, they're going to accept you for what you are. People who knew you before you were a Christian, they know what strings to pull, what buttons to push. And the devil will make good use of it. So often it's easier, much easier, unless it's a little kid, to get somebody else to witness to an unsaved loved one. In the legal profession, they tell you, don't represent a relative. In the medical profession, unless it's an emergency, don't treat a relative. Objectivity goes out the window. It becomes emotionally impossible and spiritually almost impossible to be objective when you're dealing with family. Whatever seems good to you, I will do. Find trusted brothers and sisters, trusted ones, who are discreet and who have wisdom. It's so difficult to be objective when you're dealing with family. The natural propensity we all have is to think with our emotions when we're dealing with relatives. Particularly children, siblings, things like that, parents. When you're in a crisis involving a family, involving an unsaved loved one, remember, it's almost impossible for you to be objective. Whatever seems good to you, I will do. But the king in verse 5 charged Joab and Abishai and Ittai, saying, deal gently for my sake with the young man Absalom. And all the people heard when the king charged all the commanders concerning Absalom. I know he's backslidden. I know he's unbelieving. I know he's treacherous. I know he's doing things that are unspeakable. Against God, against his family, against his nation. It's unspeakable what he's doing. But he's still my son. We just dedicated little Lily. I don't care if Lily is 20. I don't care if little Lily is 40. Her parents are always going to remember that little baby they were holding on this platform today. I don't care how old she gets. That's just the way it is. By God's design. By God's design, blood is thicker than water. I know he's no good. I know he's this. I know he's that. I know what he's doing. But he's still my son. Please don't let him get hurt. I had to speak at a big conference here in California once. And I knew the place where my son was in Israel was getting shelled by Katushas, by the Muslims and from Lebanon. And I couldn't get a phone call through, see how he was. It was terrible. When I finally got a phone call through, I heard sirens going off in the background, getting the shelters. It's very difficult, you know, when you know your son is in a place where he's strategically vulnerable. My son was in the Israeli army and things like that. Very, very difficult. Very, very difficult. Fortunately, Jack Kibbs, you know Jack Kibbs, the Calvary pastor, he knew an Israeli general, and he got a phone call through to Israel. And he actually got a general in the midst of the war, and the general found out the place my son was at, where it was at, and that he was all right. I had to go out speak in front of 3,000-4,000 people when my son was under attack. It was very difficult that day. Somebody else's son? Well, I'll pray about it. When it's your own son? Everybody heard him. And verse 6, the people went out into the field against Israel, and the battle took place in the forest of Ephraim. Ephraim is a metaphor for the 10 northern kingdoms, and the people of Israel were defeated there before the servants of David. And the slaughter there that day was great, 20,000 men, huge casualty figures for those days. For the battle there was spread over the whole countryside, and the forest devoured more people that day than the sword devoured. More were being caught in the thicket and killed by the thicket than were killed in the actual battle. It would remind one of the Battle of the Wilderness in the American Civil War. Something similar happened. And Absalom happened to meet the servants of David. In verse 9, for Absalom was riding on his mule, and the mule went under the thick branches of a great oak, and his head caught fast in the oak, and he was left hanging between heaven and earth, while the mule that was under him kept going. When a certain man saw it, he told Joab and said, behold, I saw Absalom hanging in an oak. Then Joab said to the man who had told him, now behold, you saw him. Why then did you not strike him there to the ground? And I would have given you 10 pieces of silver and a belt. Now there's a whole typological meaning in that. And the man said to Joab, even if I should receive 1,000 pieces of silver in my hand, I would not put out my hand against the king's son. For in our hearing, the king charged you and Abishai and Ittai, saying, protect for me the young man Absalom. Otherwise, if I had dealt treacherously against his life, and there's nothing hidden from the king, then you yourself would have stood aloof. Then Joab said, I will not waste time here with you. So he took 3 spears in his hand and thrust him through the heart of Absalom while he was yet alive in the midst of the oak. And 10 young men who carried Joab's armor gathered around and struck Absalom and killed him. Then Joab blew the trumpet, and the people returned from pursuing Israel, for Joab restrained the people. And they took Absalom and cast him into a deep pit in the forest and erected over him a very great heap of stones. And all Israel fled each day to his tent. This is called an amphictyony. And by tradition, a present Hasmonean structure is built on the same location in the Valley of Kidron. It may not be historically true, but that's where, by tradition, Orthodox Jews believe it is, not just outside the Temple Mount on the southeast corner, essentially. Now, Absalom in his lifetime had taken and set up for himself a pillar, which is in the King's Valley. That's where it is. For he said, to preserve my name. So he named the pillar after his own name, and it's called Absalom's Monument to this day. You can visit it. Then Ahimaaz, the son of Zadok, said, please let me run and bring the king news that the Lord has freed him from the hand of his enemies. But Joab said to him, you're not the man to carry news this day, but you should carry news another day. However, you shall carry no news today because the king's son is dead. Then Joab said to the Cushite, go tell the king what you've seen. So the Cushite bowed to Joab and ran. Now a Cushite, or a Cushi in Hebrew, is the same as the Hebrew term for a black African. In biblical times, they did not know about the Congo or about Kenya or about Zimbabwe. They knew about Ethiopia, the land of Cush. So the Hebrew term for a black African and an Ethiopian is the same term in biblical Hebrew and even in modern Hebrew, a Cushi, a Cushite. It was a black person. Now Ahimaaz, the son of Zadok, said once more to Joab, but whatever happens, please let me also run after the Cushite. And Joab said, why would you run, my son, since you will have no reward for going? But whatever happens, he said, I will run. So he said to him, run. Then Ahimaaz ran by way of the plain and passed up the Cushite. And man, he must have had a fantastic pair of trainers to outrun a soul brother. They win all the gold medals in the Olympics. Now David was sitting between the two gates, and the watchman went up to the roof of the gate by the wall and raised his eyes and looked, and behold, a man was running by himself. And the watchman called and told the king, and the king said, if he's by himself, there's good news in his mouth. And he came nearer and nearer. The Hebrew term for good news is bisorah, bisorah. In the Septuagint, it is evangelion. It is the same term in both Greek and Hebrew for gospel. It is the same term in both Greek and Hebrew for gospel. There's good news. There's gospel in his mouth. That's what he says. There's good news in his mouth. If he's by himself, there's good news, and he came nearer and nearer. In verse 26, the watchman saw another man running, and the watchman called to the gatekeeper and said, behold, another man running by himself. And the king said, this one also is bringing bisorah, good news, evangelion, gospel. And the watchman said, I think the running of the first one is like the running of Ahimaaz, the son of Zadok. Obviously, he was a professional messenger, and they were able to recognize him at a distance by his running style of his sprint. And the king said, this is a good man, and he comes with good news. Good man with good news. And Ahimaaz called and said to the king, all is well. And he prostrated himself with the king with his hand, and he said, blessed is the Lord your God who's delivered up the men who lifted their hands against my lord the king. And the king said, is it well with the young man Absalom? First words out of his mouth. Oh, David, you won the battle. How's my son? May the Lord do the same to all the people who raise up against you. How's my son? The first thing he cared about was the welfare of his son. He wasn't interested in the military news. He wasn't interested in how the battle went. He wasn't interested in anything until he first found out, how's my son? He was fixated on my son, my son, my son. That's all he could think about. That's all he wanted to know. Verse 29, is it well with the young man Absalom? And Ahimaaz answered, when Joab sent the king's servant to your servant, I saw a great tumult, but I didn't know what it was. He knew very well what it was. He didn't want to tell the king what had happened. Then the king said, turn aside and stand here. So he turned aside and stood still, and behold, the Cushite arrived. And the Cushite, the black man, said, "Let my lord the king receive good news, Bissorah. The Lord has freed you this day from the hand of all who rose up against you." Then the king said to the Cushite, "Is it well with the young man Absalom?" First words out of his mouth, "Is my son all right?" And the Cushite answered, "Let the enemies of my lord the king and all who rise up against you for evil be as that young man." And the king was deeply moved and went up to the chamber over the gate and wept. And thus he said as he walked, "Oh, my son Absalom, my son Absalom. Would I had died instead of you. Oh, Absalom, my son." The Hebrew text is much more emotive. Oy beni, Absalom, Absalom, oy beni. You always remember that little baby you held in your arms. You're always going to remember them from the day they were born. Every parent is going to be like that. David wasn't interested in his military victory, that the kingdom had been preserved, that Israel and Judah would be remaining in a united state. None of that mattered. Oy beni, my son, I wish it happened to me instead of you. I wish I was dead instead of you. Understand this. There's not one of us who are saved, not a Christian father or mother or a Christian grandparent, that would not die in place of their children or their grandchildren. It is the penultimate form of love called storge in Greek. There is actually a higher form of love than storge called agape. Agape is totally unconditional. You must be spiritually empowered or supernaturally empowered to agape. There's actually one place in the New Testament where somebody could be so wicked they were demonically empowered to love evil unconditionally. But you must be supernaturally empowered to agape. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. There was no reason he should have done it. He chose to do it. It's just completely unconditional. But you have to be spiritually empowered to agape. But people can storge. God created storge to teach us about himself. The reason that you or I would die to save the lives of our children or grandchildren is because we're imagio Dei beings. We're made in the image and likeness of a God who would die to save us. That is a love that God put in us to teach us about his love for us. When I was a young Christian, I used to say the cliche, "Jesus is my personal savior." I used to say that, but I didn't know what it meant. I only knew half of what it meant. I thought it meant I accepted him personally on McDougal Street in Greenwich Village in New York. Therefore, he's my personal savior. That's half of what it means. A personal savior means something much more than that, although it does include that. What it means is, if you or I were the only person who ever sinned, we're not. But if you or you or you or you, if you were the only person who ever sinned, the only one, God would have become a man and went to the cross just for you. Yes, Jesus died for all of us, but Jesus died for each of us. That's how much he loves us. How should we love him? Just think of it. You're not the only person who ever sinned against God, either am I, but even if we were, he would have went through the whole thing just for us. That's his love. And we just have a little sense of what that is through the love we have for our children. I know he's no good. I know she's no good. She's out. She's on drugs. She's whoring around. He's out. He's fornicating. He's this. He's backslidden. He's with it. But that's still my kid. We'd still die to save their life if we could. That teaches what God's like. If you're not saved, that's how much he loves you. And that's how terrible the second death is, that he'd have to do that to keep you from going to the second death. Don't walk out of this place without knowing somebody who loves you that much. If you reject somebody who loves you that much, you must hate yourself. But let's understand this further. I wish it was me instead of him. Now you have to understand the Old Testament is a shadow of the New. It's typological, it's a symbol of the New. The meaning of the Old Testament is a shadow of what's revealed in Christ in the New Testament. Under the Old Covenant, under the law, the king could only wish it was possible to die in place of somebody he loved. David could only wish he could have died to save his son. But what was not possible under the Old Covenant is possible in the New. Jesus, the son of David, the king, did die in place of someone he loved. You understand? It's showing a relationship between the covenants. But not only did Absalom die, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree, it says in the Torah. Not only did he died in such a way as it meant he was accursed of God. Not only would David know that his son died, he would have known that his son died cursed of God. I wish I had died on that tree instead of him. Under the law, that was not possible. Under the old covenant, that was not possible. Under the new, it was. The only reason you or I are not going to die is because Jesus took that curse and went to that tree in our place. It's showing a relationship between the two covenants. You're going to die cursed of God if you don't accept Jesus, who died in your place. All David could do is mourn. Now notice, Absalom was hanging on the tree and they pierced him. What happened in the gospel? Jesus was hanging on the tree and the Roman legionnaire pierced him. You understand, it's a shadow, it's an Old Testament type. I wish it happened to me. Hanging on the tree, pierced. He was pierced for our transgressions. Well, there's the messenger, this black guy, and there's Ahimaaz. Ahimaaz says, let me go tell the king. Let me tell the king the good news. We won, we won. Hallelujah. Let me go tell the king. No, you don't want to do that. You're not the one to tell him what happened. No, I want to tell the king. No, let this other guy go. So the African guy goes. But this other guy takes a shortcut and outruns him. I want to tell the king. He gets asked him, what about my son? First words out of his mouth, that's all he wanted to know, is my son all right? Well, I don't really know what was happening. There was a battle, there was a tumult, it was all confused, but you won the war. That was not his priority. This is the issue facing the church today. They only want to give the good news. They don't want to give the bad news. Don't speak about righteousness, sin, hell, judgment. Just give the good news. I read a book called The Purpose-Driven Lie. It's not based on the scripture, it's based on marketing psychology, and this book said the following. I'm quoting directly. When you see an unsaved person living immorally, like I was, shacking up with my girlfriend in First Avenue in Manhattan, and you see someone into substance abuse, like I was, strung out on coke, don't tell them they need to repent. That's a negative message. We have to be seeker-friendly. Just tell them they need Jesus in their life. Once Jesus comes into their life, then he'll clean them up. What that book does is confuses what the scripture calls justification with sanctification. The reason I don't take cocaine anymore is because of sanctification, because Jesus cleaned me up. Well, he's in the process of doing it. But that's not how I was justified. Unless somebody repents, Jesus is not coming into their life. Repent and believe the gospel. Save yourself from this wicked and perverse generation. I saw you have some material by my friend Dave Comfort, Ray Comfort, nice Jewish boy from New Zealand. I did a conference with Ray in England. He has a tape called Hell's Best Kept Secret. Boy, is he right. Don't preach grace until you preach law. Unless people know they're lost, they won't know how good it is to be found. Where did the apostles ever teach a gospel without repentance? Where did John the Baptist ever teach that? Where did Jesus or the Hebrew prophets ever say such a thing? Where did anybody who God ever used to bring revival do that? Where did John Wesley do that? Where did D.L. Moody do that? They never did that. Unless somebody is convicted of sin, the Greek term is eklenktos, eklenktik. Unless there is a conviction of sin and a repentance, they're not going to be truly born again in the biblical sense. No repentance, no true regeneration. They have to come to that realization of sin and the need for repentance. It is a false gospel. There was another deceiver from here in California who wrote a book, and he said, "We're going to take the gospel out of the language of the courtroom and put it into the language of the family living room. Instead of God as an angry judge, we're going to have God as a loving father." The two are not mutually exclusive. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John put the gospel in the language of the courtroom. Jesus was put on trial in our place. We were guilty of the things he was accused of. He was innocent, but we were guilty of it. You cannot know God as loving Father until you understand he is an angry judge who will judge sin. Oh no, we have to be seeker-sensitive, user-friendly. A diluted gospel is useless. I just want to give the good news. I don't want to give the bad news. Don't tell me about unsaved people going to hell. Don't tell me about my loved ones dying without Christ. I don't want to hear that. I want a positive message. This is based on pop psychology. It's not based on theological reality. Just give him the good news. I want to give the good news. He's a good man and he has good news. Grace is free, but it is not cheap. You hear what I said? Grace is free, but it is not cheap. It cost God everything when he gave his son in my place and in your place. Free, yes. Cheap, no. But too much of the modern church has cheapened it. Just give the good news. God loves you, has a wonderful plan for your life. Just put your hand up, brother. Yes, I see you, sister. God bless you. Man, I got friends in hell from drugs, and I should have been one of them. I was more crazy than most of them. Nobody wants to face this. Absalom. That's my mother in that coffin. I have an unsaved mother in her 80s. That's my father in that grave. That's my husband in that casket. That's my daughter on that slab. That's my son who's dead in that body bag. You're standing at the grave. My sibling, that's my brother, that's my sister, that's my mother, and they left this life not knowing Jesus. There is nothing more difficult than dealing with. You can deal with career setback, financial setback, crisis in health, business failure, failed relationships. Oh, I'm 33 and the biological clock is ticking away and I don't have a husband yet. You might have lucked out, lady. You could have wound up with a bum like me. That's stuff you can deal with. That's stuff you can deal with. But the death of an unsaved loved one? How do you deal with that? How do you deal with that? If they were a Christian, you have a future hope, a certain hope. If they weren't, what hope do you have? People take respite in the fact that, well, maybe they accepted the Lord at the instant between life and death, and they had, you know, the Bible doesn't teach that. Really, the only place it speaks of that, gives us any sense of that, was in the martyrdom of Stephen. And he did have a revelation of Christ, but it was a revelation of a Christ in whom he had already believed. Now, the question is often asked, the Lord will take away every tear. How can we enjoy heaven or the millennial reign of Christ or the blessings of eternity knowing our loved ones are eternally lost? How can we enjoy eternity with the Lord knowing that our loved ones are in hell? People ask that question, and it's a reasonable question. How can the Lord take away every tear? Look with me, please, to Isaiah 26, verse 14. The dead will not live, the departed spirits will not rise, and the resurrection of the righteous, of course. Therefore, thou hast punished and destroyed them. Thou hast wiped out all remembrance of them. No, they are not annihilated. But what is annihilated is our remembrance of them. You understand? In eternity, we will not know such people ever existed. In eternity, we will not know that they ever existed. It's like an ancestor who died before you were born. You won't be able to gauge the loss because you would never have known them. That's how God is going to do it. He's going to annihilate our recollection of them. They won't be annihilated, but our capacity to remember them will be. The Lord will take away every tear. But in the meantime, we have to live with it. As far as I know, my father is in hell. As far as I know, most of my family who died are in hell. As far as I know, only God knows, but as far as we can know, unless a man is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. When it comes to family, though, that objective fact becomes somehow pliable because we begin to think with our emotions instead of our head. But it remains a fact. That's my brother. That's my mother. That's my father. This is serious business. Let's continue reading for a few minutes what happens next in 2 Samuel. Chapter 19, verse 1, then it was told Joab, behold, the king is weeping and mourns for Absalom. And the victory that day was turned to mourning, all the people, for the people heard it and said, the king is grieved for his son. So the people went by stealth into that city that day, as people who are humiliated steal away when they flee in battle. Although they won the battle, they counted it as a defeat. I don't mind lifting up the sword against Islam. I don't mind lifting up the sword against Roman Catholicism. I don't mind lifting up the sword against Jehovah's Witness or Mormons. But when I have to warn Christians about books like A Purpose-Driven Lie, I don't like lifting up my sword against my brother. You understand? There's no joy in those victories, even if you win. The book of Judges is a book of wars from beginning to end, but the costliest, bloodiest war was the last one. Because the last war in the book of Judges was not Hebrew fighting Amalekite or Hebrew fighting Philistine. It was Hebrew fighting Hebrew. When you lift up a sword against your brother, even if you win, joy in that victory. And the king covered his face and cried with a loud voice, "My son, Absalom, Absalom, my son, oy beni, Absalom." Then Joab came into the house of the king and said, "Today you've covered with shame the faces of all your servants who today saved your life and the lives of your sons and daughters and the lives of your wives and the lives of your concubines by loving those who hate you and hating those who loved you. For you have shown today that princes and servants are nothing to you. For I know this day that if Absalom were alive and all of us were dead, you'd be pleased. Don't you think these people who fought for you, who put their lives on the line to save your neck and to save this country, don't you think they have sons? Don't you think they have brothers and fathers and husbands? Don't you think they have as much grounds to grieve as you do? And you're crying over Absalom. Would you have rather these people who fought for you died and Absalom lived?" That's what he asked the king, and he must have had some audacity to ask that of a king. But he was right. Verse 7, "Now therefore arise, go out and speak kindly to your servants. But I swear by the Lord, if you do not go out, surely not a man will pass the night with you. And this will be worse for you than all the evil that's come upon you from your youth until now." There is one thing worse than coming to terms with the death of an unsaved loved one. One thing worse: not handling it scripturally. It's a terrible tragedy. But if you don't come to terms with it scripturally, if you're simply ruled by your own emotion and grief and sense of loss, you will never be able to deal with it. It will destroy you. It'll destroy you emotionally. It will wound your spirit grievously. These other ones who fought for you, what about them, David? I pray every day my mother gets saved. My father's eternally lost as far as I know. I pray every day she gets saved. But if God forbid she doesn't, how am I going to deal with it? How are you going to deal with it when it happens, and it happens to believers? We all have to deal with this. There's no way getting around it. You can read all the books of pop psychology masquerading as doctrine we want. It's not going to help you cope with the reality. This is reality. It's only this is going to help us cope. The rest is all rubbish. If it doesn't agree with this, throw it away. Let's look. Your mother and your brothers are outside. "I'm sorry, but your father died unsaved. I'm sorry, but your sibling died unsaved. I'm sorry, but they died and they weren't saved. I'm sorry. That's terrible. Your mother died unsaved? Behold my mother and my brothers. Whoever does the will of my Father who's in heaven, he's my brother and sister and mother. It is a wonderful blessing if your husband is a believer. It's a wonderful blessing if your wife is a believer. If you have the advantage, the privilege, the blessing that I didn't of having Christian parents, I envy you in a manner of speaking. It's a wonderful thing to have siblings who are believers. I have a sister who's a believer. It's a wonderful thing to have family who are saved. But the fact of the matter is, if you don't even know me, and you're not missing much if you don't, I am eternally closer to you than your own brother if he's not saved. You are closer to me than my own father who died unsaved. Oh, it's my brother. Oh, it's my mother. Oh, it's my sister. You are my mother. You are my brother. You are my sister. We're together forever. He who does the will of my Father. In the few moments that remain, I would like us all in earnest to beg God, to beseech him, to plead with him for the salvation of our unsaved family and loved ones. For that brother, that sister, that son, that daughter, that parent or grandparent, there's nothing more important than this. After our own salvation, there is nothing more important than the salvation of our families. God is a God who hears prayer, who answers prayer. And as much as we love our families, as much as we love our unbelieving families, as much as we love them, God loves them even more than we do. As much as we want them to be saved, as much as we desire their salvation, God wants them to be saved more than we do. He's a God of salvation. After our own salvation, there is nothing more important than this. Let us come before the throne of grace and beg God for the salvation of our unsaved families. Let's pray. You just bring those people, that person, that son, that daughter, that parent, that sibling, that unbelieving husband, that unsaved wife, grandparent, whatever, God knows, you bring them to Jesus. Ask him to do anything that's necessary to see them come to the cross.
Mark the truth.
Lord God, you are indeed a God of salvation. For that mother, for that father, for that son, that daughter, that husband, that wife, that grandbrother, that sister, that one we love, we desperately plead with you, Lord God, to intervene, to convict them of their sin, draw them to salvation in Jesus, in his name, the only one who can save them. In his name we pray. My dear friends, I know there's people here today, as does the pastor, who've not been saved, who've not been born again. I'm not talking about the televangelist saved. I'm talking about the gospel saved. He died in your place. You are in trouble. You are going to the same hell I was going to. But there's a way out, and one way out only. He loves you so much. He loves you so much. He doesn't want you to go to that terrible place. He was nailed to that cross in your place. And he rose to give you eternal life. And if you ask him to forgive you, he will. He's never turned anybody away. He's never turned anybody away, not even me. And he won't turn if you don't know the Lord Jesus, if you've never truly accepted him, please come forward and accept him now. Please just come up and ask him to forgive you and give you a new life, and he will. Just come up and he will forgive you. Nobody's going to think you're this or that or religious or crazy, but you're desperately ill. You are terminally ill, and Jesus has the cure. In fact, Jesus is the cure. Come and accept him now.
Jacob and I both know what it was like to be way far from God and thought we were okay. God is calling you this morning. Don't hesitate. We want to pray with you this morning. We want to pray with you this morning. So as the worship team plays and you don't know Christ, come forward. Nobody's going to stand on Judgment Day with you. Your friends, your homies, none of them are going to be there. You're going to stand before God on your own. Anybody else that says, I need Christ, come on. I need Christ in my life. Anybody else, join these up here this morning. Hold on. Come forward, come forward. Don't hesitate. The Holy Spirit is doing something. God was speaking to you through that message. That was not Jacob. Jacob was only a mouthpiece for God. Jacob was only an obedient vessel, but God is speaking to people. If that's you this morning, come forward. Don't hesitate. The Lord is opening up his arms to you today. We never know when that window is going to close. We never know when our last day on earth is going to be. I've done the funeral of an eight-month-old, a stillborn, all the way up to somebody who was 101 years old, and everything in between. And many of those deaths, nobody expected it to happen. God is speaking to you this morning. So if that's you, come forward with these this morning, and we're going to pray with you today as the worship team sings.
Shall rise to thee, holy.
because Jacob comes and he doesn't charge. And we always take an offering for his ministry, a love offering for his ministry. And first of all, why don't we just welcome those into the family of God that committed their lives to Christ. And I know God is doing something right now, and I'm just going to allow the worship team to play, and here's what I want you to do. Instead of us taking a love offering, there's the ushers will have bags out there as you leave this morning. And you can give your offering to Jacob's ministry. He does much more than go around teaching the Bible. He's a good friend of our ministry, but he's got a lot of other ministries that he's involved in that they planted, ministry to the most needy in the world, to the poor. So your offering to him goes to further those ministries, and he can tell you more about them if you want to know that. But the Lord is gracious, isn't he? He is so good. Listen to me. He loves you so much that he would bring Jacob and Pavia here this morning. And this is their prayer, that people come into the kingdom. The most serious thing on the face of this planet is somebody dies without Jesus. And we've always said that. Some responded this morning. I want to put a call out to you. If you've been hesitating and you haven't responded, you can take care of that this morning. God's invitation is still open. Let's continue to worship the Lord. And again, we're not going to have the ushers come forward. You can give your offering in the bag as you leave, but let's continue to worship the Lord this morning.
Can he make sons out of us? Life is in his mighty hands. Our life is in our mighty hands. He can do it. Yes, he can. He will prove it. Our God can. No one else can save us. Redeem us, create a new life in us. Only Jesus can. Prove it. our God can. No one else can save us, redeem us, create a new life in us. Only Jesus can. He can do it. Yes, He can. He will prove it. Our God can. No one else can save us, redeem us, create a new life in us. Only Jesus can. And only Jesus can. Only Jesus can. Yes, He can. He will prove it. Our God can. No one else can save us, redeem us, create a new life in us. Only Jesus can.
Amen, Lord. Thank you. Father, thank you that you are able to heal, to save, to perform everything, Lord, that is necessary for our life to be in you. God, we love you. We pray that you be glorified in us. And I pray, Lord, that you would just work what you need to this week in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Sin and darkness throughout out His mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. He shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is a failure that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that justice shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Rules the nations with truth and justice shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, above all kings. conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. And worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered.
Amen.